Your Honor, the state would next present Dr. Gregory Saathoff. S-A-A-T-H-O-F-F.
Morning, Doc.
Morning.
Good morning, Doctor. We're going to be moving fast. Do you possess a medical license?
Yes, I do.
And from where?
State of Virginia.
And what specialty?
Psychiatry.
And you pursue a profession?
Yes, I'm a psychiatrist.
And you practice forensic psychiatry?
Correct.
For whom?
I'm at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville.
Do you consult with the federal government, for example, the FBI Behavioral Analysis Unit?
Yes, I serve as the conflict resolution specialist for the FBI's Critical Incident Response Group.
And what is that?
It is the group that contains the negotiators, the profilers, the hostage rescue team within the FBI. It's the operational division within the FBI. The response to crisis as well as violent crimes, National Center for Analysis of Violent Crimes located within the Critical Incident Response Group.
All right. And do you then interact also with other federal agencies such as Homeland Security and other committees that may be called by entities of the federal government such as courts or agencies?
Correct.
In the course of your professional career, have you had the occasion to interview a large number of serious offenders in terms of developing behavioral profiles for the benefit of educating law enforcement?
Yes, I have.
And have you previously had past exposure to cases of captivity, serial kidnapping, sexual abuse in the course of captivity?
Yes, I have.
Now, were you asked by our office to consult with us and review case materials both in our possession and in the possession of the Federal Bureau of Investigation in connection with the state of Ohio versus Ariel Castro?
Yes.
What briefly did you review?
I reviewed videotapes. I reviewed transcripts of videos that were done of three women, as well as a approximately 10-hour video of an FBI interview that was done of Mr. Castro. Documents. I also had the opportunity to interview a former girlfriend of Mr. Castro.
And was that Lillian Roldan?
Yes.
Now, moving, and did you prepare a report of opinion to our office in connection with that work that you did?
Yesterday I wrote a letter that summarized my findings.
And is that States 24?
Yes, it is.
All right. I'd like you to take us through that report by topic.
Welcome back, everyone. John Berman here in New York. On your screen there, you are seeing the sentencing hearing for Ariel Castro. He is being sentenced today for the imprisonment, the torture, the assault of three women that he kept in captivity for nearly 10 years. On the stand right now is Dr. Gregory Saathoff. He is a forensic psychologist. He is testifying that what he sees in Ariel Castro, and he has interviewed him, is unprecedented. He says he has never seen anyone with this level of planning who has held this many captives for this long. Dramatic testimony on the stand right now. Let's get right back to it.
Significant part of the case, I think, that someone would be able to, month after month, year after year, be able to devise ways to conceal the situation from family, friends, neighbors for a time. He maintained a relationship with a girlfriend who was completely unaware that he had these women in the house. His use of wigs, which has already been described, his playing of music loudly in the house. He was a musician, but the playing of music sometimes to mask any potential for the women to be heard over the music were examples. I think the use of aliases, making sure that his daughter learned the names of these women, not their real names, but used aliases, all contrived to conceal this protracted captivity.
Now, did he, in your review of materials, make any claim to anyone professionally that he needed medical health treatment or mental health treatment?
No.
And in fact, he's not diagnosed by the court clinic with having any mental health condition, correct?
His competency assessment was done by one of the most respected forensic psychiatrists in the country, Dr. Philip Resnick, who found no psychiatric illness whatsoever.
Thank you. Now, in this point number three, do you make mention of a quote by Mr. Castro that you found significant?
Yes.
And what was it?
I have quotes actually in that section. One was a statement in this document of 4 April 2004 in which he stated, quote, "I live a private life. I function around others like a normal person." And in fact, he appeared to have done that and was able to live this life around family, friends, without them suspecting. With regard to the duplicity, in the document and my discussions with colleagues at the National Center for Analysis of Violent Crime, they were struck with the fact that in the document he made the statement, "I had no idea Gina was so young, she looks a lot older." But we certainly know that he was aware that Gina was a classmate of his daughter's, he knew his daughter's age. And therefore, to make that statement, "I had no idea Gina was so young, she looks a lot older," caused some skepticism, I think, in the minds of those who were reviewing the document as to whether or not he was actually being truthful in writing the document and making the statements that he made.
Based on the entire totality of the information that you've been provided, do you have any professional reason to believe that if ever given his freedom again, Mr. Castro would not go back to his old ways?
No.
Why do you say that?
Well, the duplicity was so complete in terms of his ability to fool his family, his friends, even his girlfriend, who he maintained a relationship with at the time. The fact that he was able to construct this kind of situation day in, day out, as he said in his own statement, living a normal life, I think is quite significant. He appeared to certainly have a lot of emotion and attachment to his home, whether or not there's true or worse with regard to the victims, I think that's a great question.
Thank you. And we would next call Dr. Frank Ackford.
I've got a couple of questions, Judge, with your permission. I know there's a time constraint, but it's kind of important. Doctor, you understand that Mr. Castro was tested for competency only. He wasn't tested for a psychiatric disorder, don't you?
Yes.
Okay. And that was what the doctor who you gave such respect to, Dr. Resnick, he examined him for one purpose and one person only, not sanity at the time of the act, because that wasn't the referral by the court. It was for competency, correct?
Yes.
Competency is different, doctor, than sanity at the time of the act. Is it not? Just tell me yes or no.
Correct.
Okay. And what you put in your report, based upon the materials I reviewed, but you don't outline for us, what materials did you actually review?
I reviewed, as I mentioned at the beginning of my testimony, the transcripts of the recordings. I reviewed the competency document. I reviewed court documents related to the apprehension charge documents. I was asked to, I wrote this letter yesterday. This was not a formal exam, obviously, and I didn't have the opportunity to examine Mr. Castro.
Right, you never examined Mr. Castro, nor did you ever speak to the girls or the ladies.
Correct.